Today, our program on upper limb and lower limb pains scenarios and falls in elderly is planned and organized by Elderly Care Committee, headed by Dr. Buddhika Raigam Korala and Secretary Dr. Sankar Andeni Kumara and his team. Next, I am privileged to introduce our presenter today, Dr. Upali Banagala, the consultant orthopedic surgeon.
Thank you very much for inviting me to give this talk. It's a privilege to address the general practitioners. So I thought we as doctors, mostly 80% of the time we deal with pain. Whether it's an orthopedic surgeon or a general surgeon, physician, cardiologist, every gynecologist, eye surgeons, every time we deal with pain. So upper and lower limb pain is one of the common things which we come across in your practice as well as ours. So I thought it's better we can discuss this. There's nothing new, but I'm trying to emphasize certain things. When you are in your busy practices, it cannot be go through all the causes of pain in your, when you come across a certain area. So my my thoughts are based on my 34 years experience as a board certified orthopedic surgeon and still the practicing orthopedic surgeon. So that's where I am. Anyway, I have certain principles in my practice. Common conditions are common. Rare conditions are rare. And what your eyes see, if your brain doesn't know, you can't make a diagnosis. So this is the basic of what my talk is going to be. So I'm going to be very, very simple things to start with. Don't excuse me for that. Now, when a patient complains of pain, we are taught during our medical school. In medical school, when a patient complains of pain, we have to go through various things. First thing is the most important thing is the sight. Sight. Actually, all these years I have learned. From the site, you know 80% of the time where the pain is coming from. Then from the rest, onset, whether it's acute or chronic, the severity of the pain. I of course ask the severity because what is severe to me may not be severe to the patient. So I have a 1 to 10 scale. So 1 meaning minimal pain, 10 meaning severe pain. So the patient will describe what he thinks the severity of the pain. Then of course radiation, certain pains radiate to certain areas and we from that we can make a diagnosis. Then of course certain things will aggravate pain and certain things will relieve pain. So those are important when you are making a diagnosis. Then of course there may be certain associated features like fever, loss of appetite and so on. Then of course periodicity, certain pains come and go, then they come again like that. So so all these factors when you take into account, will be able to make a diagnosis of various pains. Right. Now, if you take the upper limb pain, if you take the shoulder region, the patient might complain of pain in the back of the shoulder or the scapula. Then, pain complain over the deltoid. Then, top of the shoulder, the anterior shoulder or root of the neck. So, right. So then when you come to elbow, they might complain of pain in the lateral side of the elbow, medial side of the elbow, posterior side. So each one will give us a clue in the diagnosis. So in the wrist also the same thing will apply. So palms, right. So this is one of the commonest thing. Pain on the back of the shoulder, back of the shoulder. So when a patient complains of pain in the back of the shoulder, I mean, in my experience, what I have gained is, you are 80% sure this pain is coming from the cervical spine. It does not come from the shoulder. This is very, very important. So this pain, this patient's pain, he is complaining of pain in the back of the shoulder. This is coming from the back of the shoulder or the scapula, 90% referred from the cervical spine. It is very, very rare. What are the characteristics? The features are, worse in sitting, standing and walking, relieved by lying down, worse on wearing heavy clothes, relieved by keeping the hand over the head, and radiates, if it irradiates the pain, can radiate below the elbow. So anyway, I just put a picture of a nice girl here, just to show you. Anyway, so how to diagnose? Extension of the neck and so-called purling sign. That is, you extend the neck, put a bit of pressure, extend the neck and turn towards the painful side. Then that is specific for cervical spine pain. I think I wrote another slide. This is what I said. If you keep your hand over the head, then your pain is relieved. If you, especially in the night, if they have pain down the arm, relieve it, because the tension on the nerve is relieved. Right, now if with these signs, I mean, you're almost 80% sure about the diagnosis coming from the cervical spine. Then the cause, if it is over 40 years, most likely, of course there are exceptions to this, most likely it is cervical spondylosis. But if it's under 40, this is a modern disease, but sometimes various people call that various disease, VTD syndrome, video terminal display syndrome, text neck syndrome. I'll show you some pictures of that. Yeah. Anyway, so this is the purling test. You press, turn to the head side, onto the side, and rotate to the painful side. And if this patient complains of pain in that area and pain radiate down, it is almost certain it's not sensitive, but it's specific. Sensitivity is about 50%. Not all the patients will have that. But if it is positive, it is 90% specific. So that's a good sign to do. So then, of course, if you take X-ray, then you see all these burn spurs and all that. But unfortunately, every one of us who is over 40 will have some changes in the cervical spine. So that does not necessarily mean the pain is arising from the cervical spine. Right. Now, this is the other thing which I want to tell you. This is what happens. So, this guy is, he is looking always down. So, this can give rise to all sort of things. So, I will tell you more pictures. See, this is the way he is doing. I mean, you are 100% guaranteed this patient is going to have neck pain. This is the way they should be doing. But this is the way they should do, right in front of the neck, front of the face, rather than going back. So more pictures of that, because this is so important. These people are generally going to get neck pain. And again, texting. This, you're 100% sure this patient is going, within couple of years, going to get neck pain, but this is the way they should be doing. I mean, just in case. But I put these things because of the importance. Right, so that's for the neck. So, pain in the scapular region, back of the shoulder, almost 80% due to cervical spine. Very, very rare you get tumors, infection. I mean, those are very, very rare. I mean, I also don't see much of those in my practice. Right. The next thing, pain over the deltoid. If a patient complains of pain over the deltoid, you are 90% sure this patient's pain is coming from the shoulder joint. There's no doubt. It's coming from the shoulder joint, right? So what are the characteristic features of that pain? This is mainly pain over the deltoid, your 90% is glenohumeral joint. Critical features, worse on lying down, worse on sleeping onto that side, worse at night, worse with overhead activities. Sometimes the patient pain can relieve up to the elbow. Right. So this is important. So anyway, 90% of these 90% of these glenohumeral pains are due to two conditions: frozen shoulder or adhesive capsulitis, or what we call subacromial pain. Subacromial pain, I mean, we used to call the rotator cuff tears, painful arc syndrome, calcification rotator cuff, supraspinal tendinitis, but the British shoulder and elbow surgeons had all categorized under this category, subacromial pain, because it's impossible to diagnose all these conditions. So how are we going to differentiate the two? It's very simple. You check for the external rotation. because all shoulder movements are associated with movements of the scapula. The external rotation is the only movement, is a pure glenohumeral movement. So if the external rotation is normal, it's subacromial pain. If the acromion is restricted, it's frozen shoulder. It's just simple as that. So just take the external rotation. See whether the patient can exert. Frozen shoulder means frozen. I mean, it's simple that the joint is frozen. There can't be any movements. So because the external rotation is the pure glenohumeral movement, so check the external rotation. External rotation restricted, frozen shoulder, external rotation is normal, subacromial pain. Why do you want to make a difference? Because the treatment is different. Because both need physio. So if there's subacromial pain, you need to strengthen the joint muscles, the rotator cuff muscles. Whereas in the frozen shoulder, you need to stretch because the joint is frozen. There is no point in strengthening the muscles. So you have to get back the movements back. So you have to strengthen the joint. So anyway, this is roughly frozen shoulder. There is always, because for us to move, there should be a slack in the inferior part of the joint. So in frozen shoulder, that get obliterated, thickened, and so they'll end up in a so anyway, this is a acromion. I mean, just to give you a rough idea of this thing, this is what we call the rotator cuff, this muscle, and there's a muscle in behind as well. So you can get tears in that. That will cause pain, but in this patient, they will have pain, but the external rotation will be normal, so they have to, you can easily make a diagnosis. So I said 80%, 90%, but occasionally you can have this problem. This is one of my patients about 3 weeks ago. She came with 55-year-old diabetic, and by the way, 90% of frozen shoulder patients are diabetic. So if you don't treat the diabetes, their frozen shoulder also doesn't get improved. So this patient came about 3 weeks ago, complaining of pain in the shoulder, external rotation was normal. So I didn't do any x-rays or anything. So I gave my usual treatment, came back in 2 weeks' time with pain again. But I don't know whether it's everybody, but I have this rule. If a patient comes to me for the second time with the same complaint, and if there is no improvement in the patient condition, I always take x-ray. So patient coming for the second time to me with the same complaint, with no improvement, I take x-ray. So that saves me, that have saved me many, many times. So this is one of those. Of course, you can see there is a erosion here. So this patient had a tumor. So ultimately, when we investigate, it turned out to be a multiple myeloma. So these things can happen. So my rule have saved me several times. So just to give you idea, so as I said, started common ones are common, rare ones are rare. So these are one of those rare ones. You have to be aware. You should have some way of coming out of it. Right. Now that's the shoulder. Then tip of the shoulder. So anyway, the diagnosis usually, commonly it's people who lift weights, doing dips, and probably fallen on the outstretched hand. And examination, there will be tenderness in the acromioclavicular joint, and there will be cross-body abduction. I'll show you this. So these patients will come pain here, right at the tip of the shoulder. Not at the back of the shoulder, not to the deltoid, at the tip of the shoulder. So these are the guys who get that keep on, because all this, when you wait, all the weight is transmitted through the acromioclavicular joint, and that gets strained, and you end up giving pain. Right. So this is what I said. So there is tenderness there, and you cross the arm. You cross the arm like that, they will have pain. Then other yeah. So that's what is. Then of course, when they raise the arm, they can go right up. But last 10 degrees, they will have pain. So that's the classical painful arc. But this they can go right up, but the last 10 degrees they can't do, they will have pain. So that's for acromic auricular pain. So I'm not going to go for the treatment. So anyway, that's the last 10 degrees of abduction will give rise to pain. Then of course, if you take X-ray, then they will have osteoarthritis and various other features. Then of course, they can have pain in the anterior part of the shoulder. So we can talk of the back of the shoulder, or the lateral part, or the anterior part. If they have anterior part shoulder, usually something to do with the biceps tendon. So there are various tests we do. I mean, I don't know, I'm not going to go into detail of that. But the main important thing is the pain is in front, and you can feel the tenderness. So this is the biceps muscle to get. So it comes along, sometimes they get irritated because there is a tunnel underneath, and it irritates and cause pain. So anyway, that's another picture. Right, then we'll come to root of the neck. So referred pain from root of the neck causes referred pain from gallbladder, liver, apex of the lung, heart, and sometimes cervical rib. But these are, I mean, I can't imagine a patient, I haven't had a patient who had come with a pain, a gallbladder problem presenting with the root of the pain neck. I mean, that's very, very unfair. These are all textbook stuff. So, I mean, these you, so they don't present that root of the neck and subsequently find out that he have got a liver problem. I mean, that's all textbook stuff. I just, for complete sake, I mean, that in my experience it has not happened. So, I don't know. But of course, this is what I said, root of the neck. So, this area. So they can have this thing. Then, of course, I just put this picture radiated from lung, diaphragm, all that. But I think it's highly theoretical thing. But some of these things can happen. So, you can see a patient with a chest X-ray with a lesion here. I mean, everyone, when you do a medical appointment, they always talk about Pancoast tumor. I don't know how many Pancoast tumors have been there, but anyway, this is one of those tumors which can infiltrate the root of the neck and cause pain. So another picture of that, so a lesion in the root of the neck. Then of course, the cervical rib can cause. Right. Anyway, I will say a few things about cervical rib. Because there seems to be a bit of confusion about the cervical rib. There are a lot of people diagnose cervical rib. But if you just have a, almost all the ribs goes up and comes down, goes up and come down, go up and come down. But on cervical rib doesn't go up and come down, it just comes down. That's the only way to identify a cervical rib. All ribs, even the first rib here, it goes up and comes down, goes up and down. But this doesn't go up, this just comes down. So that's the only way to identify a cervical rib. So this is important because it can press on the brachial plexus and cause pain. So in general, if you get a pain over the back of the shoulder, it is cervical spine. If you get a pain over the deltoid, it's a shoulder joint. If you get a tip of the shoulder, you get probably acromic auricular. But important thing is, if a patient get pain in the root of the neck, and pain radiates the inner aspect of the leg, inner aspect of the arm, you have to think seriously about some, because that may be something sinister. So any patient coming with neck pain and pain radiating on the inner aspect of the leg, there has to be something wrong, because the cervical, if cannot be, it may or may not be cervical spondylosis, because cervical spondylosis occur in C5, C6. So, but this is low down, so T1, C8, T1. So you have to be very careful when you get a patient who complains of neck pain and pain radiating down the inner aspect. Out aspect, no problem, it's commonly due to cervical spondylosis. In inner aspect, you have to be very careful. You have to exclude some sort of a pathology. I mean, it doesn't mean that it is, but some sort of pathology had to be excluded. Right. Then we'll come to the elbow. So elbow, there'll be pain on the lateral side, medial side, posterior, and anterior. So lateral pain is what we call tennis elbow, or in medically we call it lateral epicondylitis. Medial side we call golfer's elbow or medial epicondylitis. But I haven't seen a tennis player for the last 20 years or 30 years coming with a tennis elbow, because it's very, very uncommon. Because when modern days tennis players, when they buy a racket and they play, they go into the proper grip, proper strength of the thing, so very, very, very rare. Usually the housewives who come, because they want to get the last drop of water from the clothes when they twist, and then get the last drop of milk from the coconut scrapings, then they will get pain. In fact, I had a, some time back, I had a general manager of one of those Colombo hotels. He came with tennis elbow. So I have, what happened? No, doctor, I have been shaking hand with these VIPs, so now I had a tennis elbow. So that because, right. So golfer's elbow, again, can occur. That's the medial epicondylitis. I'll show you some pictures. So you have to really localize the pain, right? So anyway, now see. Now, this is the, anyway, medial epicondylitis. See, anyway, triceps, you know, I mean, just to show you the causes. But, right. So to diagnose any tendinitis, you need three physical signs. Local tenderness, tenderness at the site of the tendon origin. Then pain on active contraction of the muscle and pain on passive stretching. If you have two of these physical signs, you can safely diagnose a tendinitis. Right. So we'll take the tennis elbow. The pain is right at the medial lateral condyle. These are very, very uncommon. I put this slide just so these are uncommon things. So I'm not going to do into that. This is where they have pain, right at just above the elbow joint on the lateral side. So that's where they, that's where the, all the extensor muscles of the wrist start from there. So all the extensor muscles start from that area. Then of course, a golfer's elbow pain on the inner aspect. So test for tennis elbow, anyway, that's not a good, you can do this thing. So when you want to contract the muscles, all what you have to is to ask the patient to squeeze your hand. So they will contract the muscle and they will have pain. Then of course, passive stretching. Now this is the passive stretching of the extensor origin. You keep the elbow straight, ask the patient to pronate and palm flex. Then they will, it will stretch the extensor origin. But if you want to stretch the golfer's elbow, you take the elbow straight, supinate, and dorsiflex. Right? It's simple as that. So for a tennis elbow, you keep the arm fully supinated, straight, pronate, and palm flex. For golfer's elbow, supinate, and dorsiflex. Then they will have pain. They will invariably have pain. So local tenderness, pain on contraction, pain on passive stretching, you know the diagnosis. Of course, they are very, very different because so if a patient comes with medial side elbow pain, I mean, your first diagnosis should be this. But if the patient comes for the same thing, you can do the same thing which I do, and you can escape if there is something wrong. Anyway, so these are the wrist extensors, start from the lateral epicondyle, flexors starting from the medial epicondyle. Then, of course, you can get an olecranon bursa, sometimes called student bursa, because when they study, they keep their hand and rock forwards and backwards. Then they get irritated. Then they get, anyway, it's a very harmless condition. So that doesn't need. Right, so that's the olecranon. So we'll come down to the wrist. Right. Now, wrist, sorry, something went. Anyway. So anyway, wrist, if the patient complains of pain in the whole wrist, and if there is any restriction of movement, I think you must x-ray. Because, so if there any limitation of movement of the wrist, it could be inflammatory arthritis, various other things, and so on. So you have to x-ray. So in the upper limb, any elbow and wrist, if there is any restriction of movement, there you have to x-ray because there can be various conditions. So abduction, adduction, I just want to infer it. Right, now this patient had restriction of movement, swelling, so to see he had osteoarthritis of the wrist. So this patient who had again pain, these have a sort called Kienbock disease, this is the lunate, there is avascular necrosis of the lunate, which is a well-known condition. And so the lesson, what I do is, if the pain and limitation of movement in the wrist and is accompanied by swelling, you need to x-ray, because there is something wrong. There's something wrong, you need further investigations. Right, when it comes to whole wrist, the carpal tunnel syndrome is very, very important. But unfortunately, fortunately, our patients doesn't know the anatomy, so they complain of numbness in the whole arm. They don't complain numbness of medial three fingers, but the whole arm. So anyway, from our point of view, we know the ulnar nerve supplies the medial three fingers, the lateral three fingers, and the ulnar nerve supplies the lateral medial 1.5 fingers. But the patient generally complains of numbness of the whole hand. So the typical history would be pain on hold on to something, telephone, when they hold on to something, they can't hold it for too long, or they want doing something at home, they cannot for too long. And other thing is, in the middle of the night, they wake up with numbness of the hand. So with that, of course, we do various tests. Tinel tests, that is, we just tap on the radial nerve, median nerve, so they can get sort of sensation down the arm. Or you can do this test, Fennell's test. You keep the arm bent for some time, and then they will get the feeling of the numbness. So that's how you diagnose carpal tunnel. So once you make a carpal tunnel, once you make a diagnosis, then of course, as a surgeon, I think you need surgery. But there are people who give steroid injections, splints, and all that. The important thing is, in carpal tunnel, when they have symptoms, they have intermittent symptoms. So they have symptoms, and sometimes the symptoms disappear, depending on the compression. But as time goes on, they will have continuous numbness. The continuous numbness is because of the nerve is already damaged. Because if you treat a carpal tunnel when they have intermittent symptoms, if you operate tomorrow, by tomorrow next morning, his symptoms are all gone. Pain is gone, numbness gone, everything is gone. But if you operate on a patient who have permanent numbness, when you operate, the symptoms will become worse for a couple of weeks. Why? Because the nerve had not been conducting. Now he suddenly start conducting impulses. So patient will feel a lot of abnormality. So you have to, anyway. So those are important things. So when you have patient with carpal tunnel, better to refer early and get it sorted out. Right. So that's the other one. Now when you come to the wrist, apart from the whole wrist, you have to identify which part of the wrist this patient is complaining of pain, whether it's on the lateral side or the medial side. So this is very important. Now, lateral side pain is, right. Now, lateral side pain. So you have to see whether lateral side or medial side, because lateral side causes are different, the medial side causes are different. So anyway. So it is very, very important you identify exact location on the lateral side the pain is. Now, if you extend your thumb, you get a depression. That is what we, in our medical school, we were taught it called the snuff box, right? Now, that is where, or that is also where the wrist joint is. Now, you have to identify where the pain is, whether it is proximal to the depression or distal to the depression. If it is proximal to the depression, then it's very simple, you know the diagnosis. It is decurvent sternosinovitis. Of course, there can be anything. But 80% of the time, the people who come with the left side of the wrist pain, if the tenderness is proximal to the this depression, that is the radial styloid. So proximal to the depression, it is decurvent sternosinovitis. Decurvent sternosinovitis is because the extensor pollicis brevis and abductor pollicis longus comes in a tunnel. So because our thumb is equal to all four fingers. So when you keep on moving the hand, it get irritated and it get become painful. So this is a tendinitis, local pain, pain on active contraction, you get the patient to extend the thumb under resistance, and you do this test. Stretch the you. What you do is you keep the thumb, bend the thumb, and do it. They will jump up if they have. So then you know the diagnosis: decurvens, tenus, synovitis. So anyway, this is called Finkelton's test. So they get severe pain. So right now here the pain is little more distal, right? Not on the neck. So that's the diagnosis different. So that most likely in many of the patients is due to osteoarthritis of the carpometacarpal joint of the thumb. I'm talking about 80%. About other, there are 1001 causes, but this is the commonest cause of this condition, right? So it's very simple. You get that depression, see whether the patient pain is proximal to that or distal to that. If it is proximal, you're in your VC clinics, the initial diagnosis is decurvens. If it is distal, initial diagnosis is osteoarthritis. If you want a confirmation, you can always get an X-ray. So that's like that. Right, on the medial side, it a little bit more complicated. There is an important structure inside, what we call triangular fibrocartilage injury here. This is a piece of plastic-like structure spanning between the wrist and the red one. Now, this can cause pain, right? So this is initially you diagnose there is pain on the wrist side. There are other causes as well, but this is the commonest. If you get a pain on the patient with on the ulnar side, it is mostly due to this. So if you take X-ray, there is normal. If you take MRI, then you might show some lesion, so you can try a steroid injection, but failing that, you have to operate. So that's the difference. Right, then of course, you can have ganglia, trigger finger, and all that. So this is a ganglion. I never operate on ganglions anyway, because these are harmless conditions. You can easily diagnose. These are fluid-filled thing. Then, of course, these are trigger fingers. So there is a pulley system in pulley. So this to prevent the fingers from straightening. So A1 pulley. So the treatment is either give an injection or to divide the A1 pulley.